With Jesus as and to say both mentally and physically, a son a sad and fond farewell to a wonderful and lovely man.
Yes.
Who we are all so privileged of. Yes. Family of God, we will see our dear Master this year again, beyond the clouds of heaven. We'll meet him on the shores of the sweet by and by. As the pallbearers take their place and carry to our brother, we will sing when we all get to heaven. When we all get to heaven.
Because he give you a peace that passes all understanding.
And if you don't know what Jesus meant, you don't know what I'm talking about. But you see the thing about Jesus' miracle, he gives a hope. A hope that I don't know how to explain the miracle. It's just something supernatural. And this that you're going to work in some place. So cry and let it out. Because this too shall pass. So let's try and stick it over. And you're never alone. Your house.
Bring it out, brother.
Yeah. Do it in more style.
Yes. Alright, go on.
You want to clear it, Mr. You know what? Enough is enough.
They said, "Throw dust on their panic." We do that. They make it measure. I'm not going to go back. He's still a part of me. They say, "You need to go." You know what? I need to. I'm going to plant you. Seriously, going to plant you. Enough is enough. I'm okay, I'm right back just in case.
Thank you. until Sister Merkel returns. I will share something with you. You see, death is a very unwelcomed guest. It's a depressing fact of life. No sooner are you born, guess what? You die. No sooner you're born, you die. It's an uninvited guest, unwanted, and it comes knocking at every single door. No matter who you are, where you're from, uptown, downtown, across town, and around town. You see, the world today will let you or give you the impression that no one really dies. So the world will give you, the world will give you the impression that no one really dies. So several persons, they will pass a young child over the casket seeking some form of protection. They will wear all different kinds of apparel. They will do all manner of things because they are of the impression that although the body goes down into the ground, the person is still around. The person is still able to influence decisions. The person is still able to touch your life. The person is still able to control things. So often you will hear persons say, "Did you get that special rub? Did you apply a little rum or alcohol to the situation? Did you wear that tape measure around the waist?" And they'll say so many different things to you. But there was an engravement placed on a tombstone, and I'll read it for you. It reads, "Stop, my friend, as you go by. As you are now, so once was I. As I am now, you soon shall be. So prepare yourself to come after me." But a little boy, as he passed through the cemetery one day, he saw the words engraved on the tombstone. But he became very concerned, so he took out his little crayon and he started to write. He wrote this: "To follow you, I'm not content until I know where you went." Socrates, as he was about to, the act of his sentence was about to be played out. He was supposed to drink poison. That was his death sentence. And before he drank the poison, he said, "Farewell. I go the way of all flesh. But whether to live or to oblivion, I know not." You see, there is always a mystery surrounding what happens to someone after they die. But the fact of the matter is this: none of us truly know or truly understand what happens after death, except what the Bible reveals. None of us really know, because none of us have really what? Experienced it. So none of us have a good understanding except what the Bible reveals. So follow me carefully now as we go to Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7, as we just examine for a little bit what the Bible says about someone, how they are made up. So Genesis 2 and verse 7, the Bible says, "The Lord God formed man out of the what? The dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils what? The breath of life, and what? Man became a living soul." God breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, or the spirit of life, and man became a living being. This breath or spirit is what keeps the body alive. So when we look at what James said, James in James chapter 2 and verse 26, the Bible says, the body without the spirit is what? It's dead. The body without the spirit is dead. So there's a simple equation. What is that equation? Body plus breath or spirit equals what? A living soul. So let's go again. Body plus breath or spirit equals a living being, a living soul. So what we have here, apart from the casket, is the body. It's the body. But the body has no what in it? It has no breath or the spirit. So the body alone is the body alone. Isn't that so? So the body plus the spirit equals a living being, a living soul. Notice what Job says. In Job chapter 7, reading verses 9 and 10, Job says, as a cloud vanishing and is gone, so he who goes down into the grave does not return. He will never come back to his house. So it doesn't matter what they said about the gentleman who died. And you know, even at a funeral, even for the worst person, persons will still say good things. But notice what happened. It doesn't matter what they said about him being a good man or whatever the sort. When he dies, the Bible describes it as what? As a cloud that just goes up and disappears. Psalm 146, verses 3 and 4. The Bible tells us, put not your trust in whom? In princes, nor in the son of man, in whom there is no what? No help. Listen to this part now. It says, his breath goeth forth, he returneth to his earth. In that very day, his thoughts perish. So it is difficult for you to say that, you know, oh, brother X or sister Y, dreaming. You know, that's what I always say, dreaming. Dreaming. You know, I got a vision from. And now I know that I must be careful today because X or Y tell me, say, this is going to happen. Notice what Ecclesiastes 5 and 9 and verse 5 says. For the living know that they shall what? The living know. When you're sick, you know that something is about to happen. The living know that they shall die. But the dead knows nothing. Neither have they what anymore a reward. They cannot get anything. They cannot do anything. They cannot extend themselves anymore. Because what happens? For their memory is what? It's forgotten. Their memory is forgotten. So there is nothing, and you know, and that is why, brothers and sisters, we are encouraged that, listen, when we have the opportunity to live our lives a particular way, we must do it. Why is that so? Because when you are dead, there is no one. There's no second chance. There is no waiting ground to say, okay, guess what? I am living now. I am living it up. I'm doing as I please. But when I die, there's a little window. There's a little gap that I can go and, you know, confess and make all about turn and give my life to God. And when whatever happens afterwards, I will be safe. I'll be in heaven. The Bible says, for the living know that they shall die. But the dead, your memory is what? It's gone. But many will testify. Many will say to you, guess what? Well, you know, I have the opportunity of speaking to my dead uncle. You know, my grandmother dreaming, or my mother, you know, I got a dream from my mother. Many will say to you, but Pastor, just because you haven't experienced it doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. Isn't that so? Yes, but when we look at Revelation chapter 16 and verse 14, there's a very strong message there. The message says to us, that they are spirits of devils working what? Working miracles. So not everything that is supernatural is from God. And that is what he must realize not everything that is supernatural, not everything that you see happen out of the ordinary, you must say, man, it's God do that, you know. It's God do that. No, the Bible tells us that there are persons, that there are spirits out there that will come in and impersonate. And they will come in and they will do several things. So when you see certain things happen and you say, man, guess what? You know, say, it must be that uncle, it must be that cousin who come and say that, listen, the Bible says that there are many different demonic spirits that what? They work miracles. They do things. And that is why each and every one of us must know God for what? Himself or herself. That is the thing, because if you are depending on a miracle to be saved, the devil can do that too. If you are depending on a healing to take place, to give your life to God or whatever, the devil can step in, and that which he has put on you, he can take it back off. That's the reality of it. So we must be careful that we don't attribute every single thing that is wonderful and good, every little thing that we see happening, say, oh man, you know, says the Lord did this or the Lord did that, because we must be very careful. Persons in Jesus' day recognize that, guess what, when somebody is dead, the person is dead. You remember the story with Martha? What happened? When Jesus said to Martha, that listen man, guess what? You know, Lazarus, he will raise again, you know. Martha said, listen, oh yes, Lord, I know that. I know that he will raise in the resurrection. When you come and when God comes, I know that. But she had the impression, she had the knowledge that guess what? When somebody is dead, the person is dead. There's no going around it, no activity taking place. The person is dead. It is recorded in John. That story is recorded in John chapter 11, and the specific verse is verse 23. So, is it a case that death is the victory? Death has the victory? That this is the end of it all? What happens after death? Is this the end of it all? We just live, eat, sleep, there, die, and that's the end of the story. Listen to this quotation. It says, by Jesus' death on the cross, his burial in the tomb, and his glorious resurrection, he granted the victory not only over sin, but over death.
Amen.
He granted the victory not just over sin, but over death. And I like John 11 and verse 25. Jesus proclaims that I am the what?
Resurrection
and the life. And he that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. You see, I want you to remember something this evening. And it's simply this. The resurrection of Jesus, Jesus' followers, is as certain as Jesus' resurrection itself. Let me go again. The resurrection of Jesus' followers are as certain as Jesus' resurrection itself. When someone dies, that is the end of their story right now. That's the end of the story. And you may be wondering why at a series like this we are speaking of the state of the dead. The fact of the matter is simply this. You see, from the beginning when man sinned, this was the great deception. This was the greatest deception. When Satan says, listen, you shall not surely what? You shall not surely die. So from that point, it was a great controversy, because Satan has constantly been planting in the minds of man that, listen, yes, something will happen and you will go in the ground, but you will either come back like a cat or a lion or a princess or a king in the new life. You will not surely die. There is something else. When you go down, you will either go to a land where you will keep on flying around and all of these things and so forth, or some of you will go straight into hell where you'll be burning for millions and millions of years. This is the concept that the devil sold. So listen, you shall not surely die. And that is why when we speak about the state of the dead, it is something for us to really understand and know that, listen, I am here today. I must make use of the opportunity I have now, because tomorrow is guaranteed to no man. Because here comes a time, it doesn't matter what you have, your level of education, it doesn't matter how far you are along the financial plane, it doesn't matter who you are, there comes a time when every single man, if God doesn't put in his appearance before then, every single man will go under the ground. Go under the ground. Every single one of us. And there is no repentance. There is no turning around of things. There is no, you know, so it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how many knockings you hear. It doesn't matter how many persons come by and tell you that, guess what? You know, did you sprinkle that thing? It doesn't matter if you go to your bed and you have many dreams. I dream too. It doesn't matter your situation. When a man goes down into the grave, that's the end of the story. Your chapter in this life would have ended. The last breath you take is the last word that is written. That's the end of the story. Are you prepared for that day when the last breath leaves your body? Or is it the case that you are waiting until afterwards to make wrongs right? You're seated here. Some of us, we have been a part of the church for a long time. Some of us, we are visitors, just came off the street enjoying this wonderful presentation. See the crying, the wailing, and the gnashing of teeth, and those who weren't gnashing teeth, gnashing gum, and all the other things. But the fact of the matter is, are you ready for that time when the last breath leaves you? Have you made preparation? Are you living the life now that really counts, that really matters? Is it just a grand playing field? You live, you eat, you die, and that is it. Socrates says, listen, he doesn't know after he drinks that poison, hemlock poison, if he will live or he will disappear. But our Bible tells us that each and every one of us, we rest in the grave until the day of judgment. Until the second coming, our Bible tells us that every single one of us must give an account. Our Bible tells us that while we are there, there's nothing we can do. The story has ended. This evening, as the praise team comes forward, this is a sobering message this evening. Are you living the life that really matters? That really counts? You have been to many funeral services. You have seen where we have laid to rest good men and bad men. Many of us, we would have cried many tears. But the question is, will that, when you think of your own family, will that circle be unbroken? of your household, will that circle be unbroken? When you think of your church, those persons in your Sabbath school class, will that circle be unbroken? When you think of your community, brothers and sisters, as the praise team sings, I'm going to give another call at the end after the praise team sings. But I want you to listen to the words. It's the same song that is sung every night. And we do this so that you can remember. But this evening, the message is simply this. Let us live our lives today so that God may be pleased.
Since I start, Jeff, for the kingdom, since my life in control, since I
convenient thing to do, to raise my hand. It's a convenient thing. let me do it right now. You know yourself, my sister. My brother, you know yourself. Yes, you. And you. And even you. You know yourself. You know that if the Lord put his appearance right now, things are looking too good. But here's an opportunity for someone to raise your hand. You have not given your life to the Lord as yet. So this is the first section. You have not given your life to the Lord as yet.
Clear. demonstration of the gospel.
Amen.
Through drama and the spoken word. We are reminded that one day death will lose its sting and the grave will be victorious.
Amen.
This is all because of Jesus, the one who conquered death. The call went forth. Hands have been raised, signifying that we dare not leave this place this evening unless we are sure that we are grounded in Jesus. So, Holy Spirit, we ask you now to release a special anointing on each participant. Place a special empowerment on your manservant. And each night when we come, may we come with that determination that we will make Jesus the center of our lives. We thank you for each person that is here tonight, those who are visiting, those who raise their hands, whatever their needs are. Holy Spirit, please shower down your power on them. Dismiss us with your blessings, but not from your presence. Bring us back tomorrow night for another infilling of Pentecostal showers of blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen.